So welcome to this session, a late night session, Friday late night session. And in this pre-recorded session, Lokabandhu asks, what really are the consequences of our actions? So a few months ago, I contacted Lokabandhu and asked if he'd like to contribute something to the conference. And he said, unfortunately, he's going to be away this weekend. He's going to be traveling. However, he did have a couple of carbon sadhanas that he wrote probably a couple of years ago, probably a few years ago now. And I said, well, could you record them? So this is the first of these recorded sessions. He's recorded for this conference. So what really are the consequences of our actions? And this is really a deep question when it comes to the climate and ecological impacts of our actions. This meditation, modeled on classic Buddhist visualization practice, will help us to become more vividly and graphically aware of the environmental consequences of driving. Now, some of you will already know Lokabandhu and know him well. He was ordained in 1990. And he was a founder member of Butterfield, and he's currently a Green Town Councillor and Deputy Mayor in Glastonbury in Somerset. And I heard a rumour that he's going to be the Mayor of Glastonbury next year. And I asked him about this. I said, is that true? And he said, well, if things continue as they are, yes, he's likely to be the Mayor of Glastonbury next year. So here he is with the first of his carbon sadhanas on driving.
So, hello everyone. This is Lokabandhu offering these meditations to the third Triratna Earth Sangha online conference. This is a guided visualization which all are welcome to participate in, based very much on traditional Buddhist imagery, but applied specifically to the whole area of our current lives, the current environmental and ecological issues that we face, and in particular to the activity of driving. I'm hoping it may help us visualize, perhaps a bit more graphically, the consequences of driving about, which I'm sure many of us do, even many times a day. So, the meditation may be a little sobering, maybe a little bit shocking, but I hope nevertheless it may help us just become a bit more aware of the consequences of actions, very fundamental Buddhist teaching, and therefore perhaps inform any changes we may wish to make. So, like any meditation, taking a bit of time to prepare yourself, making sure you're sitting somewhere comfortable, peaceful, maybe your phone switched off, the doors closed. The shrine is ready, the candle is lit, the incense is perfuming the room, and you are ready for a short guided meditation. Like any meditation, taking a bit of time to tune in to yourself before we begin the practice. Physically, letting your weight drop down. Any tension, relax. The earth beneath us, as always, supporting ourselves. Becoming aware of our energy, our emotions, any thoughts or distractions in our mind. trying to let go of that and simply being present for the next few minutes as we go through this guided visualization. Following our breath and perhaps using it to let go and settle a bit more each out-breath into our present awareness. Then, when you're ready, beginning to visualize yourself surrounded by an infinite clear blue sky. The beautiful and traditional start of any traditional Buddhist visualization practice. The sky stretching off in all directions completely without limit. Ourselves participating in it and in the middle of it. Beneath us, however, we can feel, sense the ground. The ground is just as described in the Pure Land Sutras. The ground beneath us we can visualize as completely flat, perfectly pure flat plain, again stretching out in all directions from where we are seated. It's made of precious stones, lapis lazuli, transparent, shining. And what we see from where we are is a network, the ground covered by a network of shining golden wires stretching in all directions, in front of us, behind us, to the left, to the right, to the four quarters and the intermediate quarters. All beings inhabit this land, and it is in fact the Pure Land. We are seated in some sort of comfortable meditation posture. And as we become aware of this, we realize we are in fact seated in some sort of vehicle, some sort of carriage, some sort of object which allows us to move around the land at will, following one or another of these golden wires. We realize that our movement, our direction, is mind-made. We can simply will to move to the front, to the left, to the right, to turn, whatever we wish. The experience of movement is pleasurable, even thrilling. We simply have to think of it and we move. Traversing the land, this land of precious jewels, traversed by myriad of golden wires. There's a sense of possibility, freedom, delight, even power, as we move to the left, to the right, and forwards. We realize we can control our speed. We simply have to will it, and we move faster, faster and faster, never looking back. Forward, left, right, whatever we want to do. We realize the vehicle, the thing in which we're sitting, is a kind of, you may as well call it a car. It's new, it's quiet, it's powerful, it's a thing of beauty. It adds to the pleasure of our experience, the thrill of our experience. Now, as we begin to think, well, what shall I do now? We realize in the far distance, there's a form, a giant form, sort of calling us. It's the form of the Buddha, seated as Amitabha, the Kamakura Buddha, Amitabha, in majestic meditation in the far distance. He is vast and still, seated in his meditation, and irresistibly attractive, though we couldn't quite say why. We turn towards him, we direct our attention and therefore our vehicle towards him, moving faster and faster through the network of golden wires across the pure land, all of which seem to move, to lead towards the Buddha. As we draw a little closer to him, we see that he's holding in his hand a mirror. The mirror, of course, allows us to see ourselves for the first time. We realize we are indeed seated in a car, a new, shiny, silent, powerful car. And we realize this perhaps for the first time. Faster and faster, we will ourselves to move towards the Buddha, flying across the shining ground. Strangely, though, we realize we're making no progress. The Buddha remains vast and still and irresistibly attractive, but far away. We begin to wonder what is going on. Why can't we reach the Buddha, who we are so attracted to, who we so desire to be close to? We realize, in fact, the form of the Buddha is fading, until we can barely see him. Although the form of the mirror remains, and ourselves and our car visualized, seen in the mirror. As we look in the mirror, the Buddha now almost having completely disappeared, we see not only ourselves and our vehicle, we see behind our car. The land, the road, the path behind us, along which we have travelled. We see this for the first time. And we see something quite surprising, even startling, even a bit shocking, behind us. Behind our beautiful, shining, silent, powerful car is a snake, or what looks like a snake. It's a kind of long, long tube extending out from the car and laid out on the path behind us, everywhere we have been. We've travelled a mile. This snake, this tube, is a mile long. If we've travelled 10 miles, this snake, this tube, this coiled white cylinder of mysterious substance, mist, is 10 miles long. A 100 miles long, even 1,000 miles long. The faster we move, the faster this snake, this white snake of shining mist, extends out behind us. It follows us everywhere we go. In size, it is the length of our path. In diameter, it's roughly the diameter of a dustbin lid, a dustbin lid. It's not too large, but not too small, but it's very, very long. We see all this in the mirror for the first time. Ourselves, our car, and this mysterious, long, white snake stretching out behind us, tens and hundreds of miles. We look more deeply into the nature of this long, white, mysterious snake, and we realize, actually, it's only air. It's only air. But it's air that has passed through our vehicle, through the engine of our vehicle, and been emitted from the exhaust. So it's not quite air, it's air containing exhaust gases from our vehicle. In particular, we realize it contains carbon dioxide at twice the volume of carbon dioxide contained in the atmosphere. Not 400 parts per million, but 800 parts per million. Perhaps a small change, but but nevertheless double. We realize that if all air on the entire surface of our planet had carbon dioxide at this doubled concentration, which it is in the snake, all life on Earth as we currently know it would be extinguished. Now, we hear a voice. Although the Buddha has almost disappeared, leaving behind only the mirror, we hear a voice which can only be the voice of the Buddha. The voice says, "I have stopped." I have laid aside the stick for all beings. You are living unrestrained with living beings. Now it is time for you to stop. Now it is time for you to stop. We realize this voice, these words, are the words the Buddha spoke to the murderer, Angulimala, who also tried to run, to move towards the Buddha, and was also unable to reach him. So we will our vehicle to stop. Our magic car, our shining new car, we will it, having heard the words of the Buddha, we will our vehicle to stop. And of course it does. It comes to a halt and we leave it. We exit our vehicle. We stand on the ground, the radiant, shining ground of lapis lazuli, for the first time, standing directly on the ground, facing the Buddha and his mirror. All around us is a mist, almost a smoke, blotting out the sight of the sky, the land, the Buddha himself. In the mist, it's hard to see clearly. We need faith to retain our vision of the Buddha and his words. We realize this mist is nothing other than the snake emitted from our car, our vehicle, caught up with us at last. It's spread out across the land, no longer confined to a simple, nice, clean snake behind us. It spread out across the land, and the whole land has become obscured with mist. This realization is painful. We have not wanted to contribute a mist to the whole land. But it's purifying. It's the painful awareness of apotropia, shame based on respect for the opinion of the wise. Contained within, perhaps, this painful feeling of shame for what we have contributed is gratitude. Gratitude for what we've learned, even joy for the freedom that comes with insight. We look again in the Buddha's mirror. Again we see in the mirror that we are not alone. Each of the golden wires that cover the land are being traversed many, many, many times. Thousands upon thousands of times by cars, vehicles. And as they do so, the snakes accumulate and rise high above the roads, spilling over and covering and obscuring the land on all sides. We realize that even if we individually choose to stop and follow the Buddha's words, that many others have not done so, have not stopped. And the land and the Buddha, perhaps, will be obscured until such time as many, many others, even all beings, have done so. Even until society itself has been transformed. Standing on the ground, facing the Buddha, looking into his mirror, we see all this, we realize all this, and we reflect on this. Very slowly, the vision fades. The infinite clear blue sky fades away. The ground of lapis lazuli fades away. The network of golden wires fades away. And the Buddha fades away. But in its place, we realize that actually nothing has changed. We are standing on the earth itself, which is the Pure Land. The Pure Land perhaps obscured with mist. And we are facing the Buddha, who is there and able to speak to us today as clearly as ever. We realize the Pure Land, paradise, is not far. The This very body is the Buddha. We reflect on our own desire to stop and heed the words of the Buddha. And our own desire to help others also to hear these words and perhaps to stop themselves. So, beginning to bring the meditation to a close, letting these images stay with us as we gradually open our eyes and we are indeed seated upon the earth, surrounded by living beings, and able, if we wish to heed the Buddha's words. May all beings be well, may all beings be happy, may all beings be free from suffering.
Okay, so that's Lokabandhu's carbon sadhana, the driving. Thank you very much for joining us this evening.